So good morning, everybody. I'm happy to be invited by Pekka. Thank you very much to take this opportunity to talk a little bit about potential new business models that can arise from 3D printing or additive manufacturing. You will notice that I will use the two terms additive manufacturing and 3D printing mixed to each other. In fact, there is a lot of debate going on how to call these technologies. Personally, I prefer to use the term additive manufacturing because it gives a bit more professionalism to the topic. 3D printing is a bit more associated with the home printing, the home use of the technologies. And I will speak this morning more about the professional applications of 3D printing or additive manufacturing. When we talk about 3D printing or additive manufacturing, this is the first image that people have. It's about machines, it's about printers, it's about materials, and that is what is going on in their mind. And this is good. We shouldn't speak about additive manufacturing if there were no printers, so if there was no hardware. But apart from the printers, there is also something like applications where to use additive manufacturing. And this is quite interesting. Today, when we see the use of additive manufacturing, it is basically popping up in all kinds of different sectors. Automotive is probably still one of the larger users of the technology, although that in the automotive industry, additive manufacturing today is primarily used to make prototypes of parts. Other tech sectors that are embracing in a large extent additive manufacturing are, for example, the aerospace industry. And in the aerospace industry here, the companies are not looking only to use these technologies for prototyping purposes. They are really looking to use those technologies to produce parts that will end up in flying planes. So there must be added value in the technology. Otherwise, why would they spend so many euros, millions of euros, in getting flying parts on their planes? There are also other sectors. I understand that this Tampere region is very famous for machine building. Well, in high capital investment goods, the use of additive manufacturing is probably taking up the fastest. It's in applications where there are not so many relatively small series, but of high capital investment products where additive manufacturing is used. And you see on the top here, that's an example, not of the pipes, what you see here, that's the offshore oil piping, but what we made here is a kind of a tractor that does the grinding, the anti-corrosion grinding of those pipes. And here, these are devices which are produced maybe in 100 volt per year and all having different diameters, so very low quantities with a lot of variables in it. And here, additive manufacturing starts to make sense to use as a production technology. We also see that this additive manufacturing or 3D printing is appearing more and more in consumer goods. And the consumer goods can be high-end design products, or this can also be, and that's something we see a lot, is in a lot of gadgets, avatars, a lot of games today, video games or computer games have a link to additive manufacturing, to 3D printing, to print out the avatar on which the player, the gamer, has been working for weeks or months. This is one group of applications. There is a second group of applications, and that group of applications is more related to the human body. These are applications that are translating data of the human body into medical models, which can be used by surgeons to prepare complex operations. This is the use of the technology to produce surgical tools to go into patients, and these are then patient-specific surgical tools to improve the quality of the operations. This is about making implants through additive manufacturing and really implanting 3D printed or additive manufactured implants into the human body. But it also relates to things which are not inside the human body, but go in the close surrounding of an individual. Think about hearing aids, customized hearing aids. Think about footwear, like personalized insoles. Think about eyewear. So things which are very closely related to the human body. Again, the reason is that these 3D printing technologies, they are so suited to make one-off components, one single parts, so to make unique parts. And if you look around you, the most unique thing in the world is probably the human being. So finding here a link between the two is something which is interesting. This is my only commercial slide, but still I'd like to show you a little bit where Materialise as a company is active. We as a company, what we try to do is basically try to connect the applications that you have on top of my slides with, the printers, which are obviously absolutely necessary to print something. And we do that through understanding the applications and the application needs. And we do that in the medical field or in the more industrial fields. And by translating those needs into data, which is specific to control, to drive the printers, but also to take data which is generated on the printers and to feed it back into the applications. And this is, for example, and I will show you an example, but this is required when you talk about medical models, for example, or medical implants or aerospace components, where you want to know at every moment in time how a certain device has been produced, who has been touching the device, what type of materials you have been using, what your machine settings were, and so on. And so that link is something that we do within our company, and that's basically the main activities that we are doing, applications connecting with the printers and vice versa. And to do so, we basically are making use of three core competencies in the company. We have a quite extensive know-how of 3D printing. At the moment, we are running more than 130 professional 3D printers, both in plastics and in metals. So we have a quite good understanding how those printers are working. Obviously, we have also a very good understanding on how software has to be developed. But we have also a core competence on engineering. And this is something which will become clear, I hope, during my talk. There is the importance of designing products, engineering products, that are suited to be produced by additive manufacturing. And in fact, I will, in the next half an hour, I will not talk that much, rather not, let's say, on the use of the technologies for making prototypes. I think that's for everybody clear that 3D printing, additive manufacturing, is the ideal tool to produce a prototype of a product in development. And when you make a prototype, in most of the cases, the ultimate goal is to produce those products through conventional technologies like injection molding, like sheet metal, what have you. What I will focus on further in my talk is rather how can we use these technologies to produce end-use parts. And in fact, take the parts coming out of the printers and then use them in real life without having a final destination of doing injection molding or so. So, and that is a mind shift that needs to happen in the mind of the designers, because if you design, and I will give an example later on, but if you design products for injection molding and you want to 3D print them, well, obviously, you will be able to print the parts. And you will get something out of the printer that looks like the injection molded part. And if you finish it nicely, if you sand it a bit and you paint it, it will even look identical to an injection molding component. It will even perform a little bit like an injection molded part, but it will never perform as you would like to have it, and certainly not in a long time durability. So if you want to use the parts over a longer time in a durable way, at that moment you really have to take the advantages of the technology into account, but also You have to account for the weaknesses of the technology. And if you do so, then you can develop products which are suited for 3D printing, so which will perform on the longer term in devices and applications where they need to stay for, in some cases, only a couple of hours, in other cases, probably 8 to 10 or even 30 to 40 years. Now, when we are talking about manufacturing, then most probably the people here out of the industry will recognize these three curves. These curves are giving a relationship between the cost of a component, and that's the first one on the left, and the series sizes. The more components you make, the lower the unit cost is of your components. Yeah. In the same extent, we also know that the higher the complexity of a part is, the higher the cost is to produce this component. Even if it's in millions, it will be more expensive than if you produce a simple component. And finally, the bottom curve gives a relationship between the size of a component and the cost. And we also know that if you produce a larger component, it will be typically more expensive than when you produce a small component. And in fact, I should make a small correction on my graph, because when you make micro components, they become again more expensive. Yeah? But let's forget a bit about the micro or nano technology and focus on the macro world. When we think about additive manufacturing, this logic is not valid anymore. This is the logic that we have in additive manufacturing. And this logic tells us that irrespective of the series sizes that you produce, the cost will remain the same. This is identical when you go to the to your photocopier and you make one photocopy. It will cost you, I don't know, 10 cents. When you make 100 copies, it will cost you 10 euros. Yeah? So the cost of scaling up, the typical economies of scale, do not apply to additive manufacturing. And this is something that we have to realize when we think about applications of additive manufacturing. The other thing is that the complexity doesn't affect the cost of a component. Making a rectangular block or making the same size of a block, rectangular block, but making it hollow and all kind of very strange features inside that rectangular block, it is costing the same. And that is another interesting feature with additive manufacturing. And finally, when we think about sizes, well, where in, let's say, the conventional technology, there is a kind of slow relationship, moving relationship between size and cost. Well, in additive manufacturing, this relationship is kind of exponential. Yeah? If you produce a part that is twice as big, it will cost you about 8 times more. And these are important relationships to bear in mind, because those relationships will tell us where we can find applications for additive manufacturing to produce end-use parts. Let that be clear. It is obviously where the horizontal curves or the additive manufacturing curves cross the conventional production curves. At the end of the day, we are talking about economies. And it must make economical sense before we are jumping into additive manufacturing. And in cases where there is not an economical advantage of additive manufacturing, well, there the technology will be limited to be used as a prototyping technology. So this is important to bear in mind where to use additive manufacturing as an end-use technology. Now, I didn't put absolute numbers on my slide here. And the reason is that because of the evolution of the technology, those curves are moving. They are in continuous progress. And that is something that I like to show on the next slide, where you see a timeline. And on the timeline, you see that there will be an evolution of sizes of components which become more economical to produce by additive manufacturing. And when we think back about 15 years ago and around 2000, in fact, around 2000, there was a first application of additive manufacturing, real additive manufacturing. And that was started by Phonak, the Swiss company making hearing aids. Already in 2000, Phonak found out that by additive manufacturing, it is possible to produce in a cost-effective way those little shells that form the hearing aids, a personalized hearing aid. And what I like to do here in this slide is make the analogy with some balls. And you probably know the marble that's for the kids. I don't know if that is done in Finland, but at least in Belgium, the kids are still playing with marbles, little balls this size, centimeter diameter. Well, this was the economical size of components that could be produced back in 2000. And what we see is that over the time, the size of those components is growing. Let's say that in 2005, around about that period, there were applications popping up in the dental industry with the production of dental bridges or guides, and those components had more or less the size of a ping pong ball. Then in 2010, with the venue of also the home printers, we saw that the size of components was further growing to, let's say, a tennis ball size, where things like phone covers were starting to be produced in a kind of cost-effective way. And then these years, we are seeing, and we experience it in our daily life, that we are producing more and more components, end-use parts, that have the size of a football. So these are already really significant components that we are producing in size. The question mark is, when will be the space hopper size available? I can't give you the answer, but I can tell you that there is this evolution, and there will come a time when also components of a bigger size will be economical feasible. What you have to bear in mind in this graph as well is that we have been, it's not just about the size of the component, it's also about the complexity. So we have to match the two graphs simultaneously. It's also about the complexity of the application, and it's about the series sizes. And we see that the smaller the parts are, the larger the series sizes can become. So when we go more to the football size component, we also see that the series sizes, economical series sizes, are getting down. Yeah. Complexity is an important aspect in this story. And what we notice is that complexity, we can also translate this into value that you create in components. And that is what I will then explain in the further slides about how can we create value by additive manufacturing in order to basically justify, in most of the cases, a slightly higher cost to produce components than what you would expect from conventional manufacturing technologies. And let's start with these hearing aids. So the hearing aids today, tens of millions of hearing aids are produced, and everything, 100% of the customized hearing aids today are produced by additive manufacturing or 3D printers. And this is fantastic. So this is a great evolution with the technology. But we have to realize something. I'm explicitly emphasizing the words customized hearing aids. So that means that every single hearing aid is different. And printing is not such a big problem anymore. The materials are good, the printers are fast, the cost is, I don't know exactly, but it will be around about a few euros to print those plastic shells. So the challenge is basically shifting not so much to the printing, but the challenge is shifting towards how do you get the data into those printers. And that was in fact a challenge with which also companies like Phonak were confronted back in 2000 when they were working on this project. So they found out, as I said already, that printing was okay, but they also found out that to get data, the CAD files on the printer, it took them more than an hour of highly skilled engineers working on extremely expensive CATIA CAD platforms. And this was, of course, not economically feasible. So they were looking to ways to change these things, and that is how we came into the game and where we developed a new type of CAD package, a package that was extremely well in designing hearing aids. And it's extremely well in the sense that today the people at Phonak are designing a customized hearing aid in less than 1 minute time. And they do it not just making some mechanical design, starting from a point cloud, but they will do collision detection for assembly. They will do finite element calculations on this hearing aid to optimize the echoing effect in such a device. They are doing artificial intelligence to automatically select out of a library the correct electronics that fit the shape, the geometry of the ear canal. So it's really a very advanced CAT and engineering system. But the only thing that this CAT and engineering system can do is one thing, is designing hearing aids. But the good thing about this, and this is what we call design automation, the good thing about design automation is that today the design is done in 1 or less than 1 minute by people who used to be the hand sculptors, the people who were manually sculpting the hearing aids before the 3D printers came. And that means that the cost of engineering those customized hearing aids is also very low. And that is something that we have to realize, that 3D printing offers opportunities for customization, but the cost to customize shifts more and more to the engineering activities of 3D printing. And let's then move to bigger components. This is an example of an hip. This is a patient who has had already a number of implants and a number of revisions. And at a certain point in time, it is not possible anymore for this patient to place a conventional implant because there is just not enough bone anymore in the patient, or bone that is strong enough to hold the implants. So these patients, they are basically bound to stay in a wheelchair and to stay in bed. With additive manufacturing, but more than additive manufacturing, with advanced engineering, it is possible to give these people a new chance and to make these people walk. And that is something that is possible thanks to the new technologies. And what we are doing here is, for example, analyzing the bones, and not just from an anatomical point of view, so the geometry of the bone, but we look also inside the bone, and we look for regions where there is no strength in the bone to hold the bolts to fix the implant. And we also take into account a musculoskeleton model. So in other words, we will take into account the weight of the patient, the position of where the muscles on this particular patient are connected to his legs and to his hip. And we take all that information into account to engineer a hip that is perfectly suited for this patient. And that is then what you get when you print that hip into titanium. Because that's a nice thing. We have only one hip, one very personalized hip. So in this case, we can produce this hip by 3D printing it in titanium. And what you can see on the picture here on the bottom side, so here, this area is in fact coming, touching the human bone. And what you see on this picture is that on that contact surface, we didn't put a regular smooth surface. No, we created here a dedicated lattice structure, a dedicated sponge-like structure. Why do we do that? Well, because in 97% of the cases, human bone really loves titanium. And what will happen is when you put the implant in contact with the patient, and you stimulate by moving forces from the legs into the hip, what is happening is that the hip, or at least the bone, will start growing inside this lattice structure. And in that way, you get a very good connection and bond between the implant and the human anatomy. And that makes that, in this way, we are able to make people move again who are bound to their beds with the conventional technology. And that is creating a lot of value. Yeah? For this value, you can afford a higher cost of a custom implant, because there is a higher cost. There is a higher cost of the printing, but obviously also there is a higher cost of the engineering involved. And this also puts us in a situation where when you start implanting such devices into human beings, that we have to take care about quality of of what we are producing. Here, it is important that we know throughout the whole process of printing layer by layer, and this can be hundreds or 1,000 layers, we have to make sure that every layer is properly done and that there is no failure in one layer, because you may not necessarily see it visually on the actual implants. But if one layer fails, it may cause failure of the whole implant. So quality control and controlled manufacturing is important. And here it's also important to have the right software tools and the right printers to work together and to make sure that the quality is assured. You also have noticed that shift from manufacturing to engineering in a lot of applications that we see appearing in the additive manufacturing world, the engineering content in the components is increasing. Yeah? The value that is created in this way is increasing. And another thing which is happening more and more, also in this case of these implants, is an interconnectivity and digitalization of the world. Yeah, it's clear that with these medical applications, everything is digital, but also we are interconnected through the internet with hospitals. There is a direct communication between our engineers and surgeons. And this happens in a worldwide network through the internet. And that is also a very important aspect, and I strongly believe that additive manufacturing is an enabling technology, but also the internet makes that our technologies become valuable. And an example of this interconnectivity is a project we've been doing with Schunk. Schunk is a German company, and they are making robot grippers, amongst others. And one of the aspects where Schunk was seeing potential opportunities was in the production of the fingers. These are the black components that you see here. The fingers that fit on the gripper base and are gripping, and the gray one is the actual component. So there is a value in making conformal fingers. And conformal fingers are fingers that have the same shape as the actual part that they have to grip and to move. Now, today, it is possible for an automation company to go online and to go to this eGrip website to upload the components which is required to be manipulated. And then the customer, the engineer, the design engineer, can select out of a catalog of gripper bases a certain gripper base that he thinks is the right one to move and manipulate a component. And once he has done that, he just has to click a button and the system will online automatically design those fingers. And those fingers are automatically conform to the actual parts that he wants to grip and which has been uploaded in the web platform. And if the engineer is happy with this design, he just has to put a button and he gets a price quotation for the grippers and a lead time. And if he then pushes the next button and he fills in his credit card, obviously, he orders these fingers, and a couple of days later, these fingers are supplied to him at his working place. This is showing how internet and e-commerce and additive manufacturing are working together and are creating value for example, automation companies. Automation companies where the design engineers are not necessarily working at the same times as a commercial person of a company like Schunk, but where thanks to design automation, thanks to the internet, and thanks to the fact that we can 3D print those fingers, that he gets a very flexible solution where he can work in the weekend, he can work overnight, he can work whenever he wants, he can get a quotation, at in his quotation stage, or he can just order when he needs those devices. This brings me then more to technical applications. And in technical applications, what we see here is that to create that value in components, the use of computers can help a lot. And computers are more and more used to do topology optimization. And topology optimization, you probably know this, but basically you start from a space, design space, which is represented here by this green volume. And in that design space, you will define a certain amount of forces that will apply to the device. And you feed that into a computer system, and the computer system will calculate you the optimal design for the component. That may look quite weird, like you see here on the picture. This is what a computer would calculate. Now, there are a couple of things with this topology optimization software. First of all, it looks weird, and for a lot of design engineers, or especially the more mechanical engineers, they don't feel so comfortable when they see this type of shapes. So it's a bit odd, and they are a bit uncomfortable to put this into production, because does it really perform like unconventionally, nicely straight components? But the second thing is that topology optimization often results in shapes and forms which are not possible to produce in the conventional methods because of undercuts, because of very strange shapes. And here, obviously, additive manufacturing can play a role, because additive manufacturing can print whatever kind of complexity. So whatever that the computer is calculating, we can produce this by additive manufacturing. So this is the good thing. Now, to give an answer on that bit odd design, what we did was we took that design and we made a bit more abstraction of the design, and we came up to this shape here. So we gave it a more conventional look from an engineering perspective. But what we also did was then, because you may notice that we took out here material out of those planes in the original design, there was material. The computer put there some material. So what we did was checking how this component would perform when we put it into a finite element analysis. And I don't know so much about finite element analysis, but what I know is that when you see in those calculations red spots, that is stress concentration. So this is not so good, and we want to avoid this. Now, you see that there are quite some red spots here in this area. So warning light. So this is not working. And what we did was adding a lattice structure inside this area to basically see if you could take away the stresses. And that works. When you put it into a finite element, it shows that the stresses are taken away. And this is then the component as it looks when you have 3D printed it in metal. Now, the interesting thing is that what we have done here is that the original design of this component was about 6.5 kilos. Topology optimization took away about, 4 kilos. Yeah? But by then doing this structured component, we still were able to remove 700 grams of this component. And that is where lightweight is coming into place. This is why aerospace is so much interested into additive manufacturing. Because for aerospace, every single kilo that they can save on a plane, that means about 30,000 euros of fuel saving over the lifetime of a plane. Yeah? This is huge. This means that you can put more passengers, more cargo into the plane for the same consumption. So every kilogram that can be saved in aerospace is a win. And that is why this lattice structure, lightweight structures, and topology optimization in aerospace is, for example, becoming so important. A quick... I'm watching the time. A quick other example is in the hydraulics. I will not go too much too deep into the case, but you know this kind of hydraulics devices. You have in the conventional world, you take a plate. You have two flows of oil, for example, in a heat exchanger. So what you do is you drill holes in one direction, holes in another direction, and then you want to have a kind of fluid circling inside the heat exchanger. So you will plug all those holes so that you have a flow of your liquids. Now, the consequence is that the liquid will flow in one direction, has to stop, turn in another direction, has to stop, flow in the other direction. So there is a lot of pressure drop, and so it's, from an energy point of view, a very inefficient design. And that is something that we have been doing, is using CFD analysis and optimizing the flow of the two liquids to minimize the pressure drop in this design. And then you get to something that you see here in the bottom picture, where you have a flow which is very fluently spreading out and then concentrating again in an outlet. Very complex shapes, but the advantage is, look at the figures, what we can realize. Yeah? Volume, 12 times smaller. Weight, 20 times lighter. Pressure loss, 7 times smaller. Yeah? And then even the bursting pressure is much higher than in the conventional design. So basically, we are able, thanks to CFD, so thanks to optimization, computer optimization, and thanks to the fact that we can print those complex shapes by additive manufacturing, we are able to make a lot of savings from an energy point of view. And obviously, if you make millions, or you have, if you are supposed to make millions of these devices, then the cost of additive manufacturing will be just too high. So here still, the series sizes are playing a role. But when you are in a sector where you need only a few hundreds of these type of devices, well, then there may be an economical sense because the total cost of ownership of such devices is dropping drastically. And then a final element that I would like to touch upon, if I'm allowed, Pekka, to take 5 minutes more, that is how to involve the consumer, because this is also something that we see with additive manufacturing, that is that the consumer is getting more and more involved into the manufacturing world. And an example, a very interesting example, is this here of the hobbyist having his model trains and his sceneries, and you have in the world, you have probably millions of people who like to play around with trains. And out of this community, you have probably a few 10,000 of people who are more the freaks and who are, let's say, not so happy with what they can buy into the shops because everybody has those model trains. And then you have out of those maybe 10,000 freaks, you have a few hundred really creative freaks. And those creative freaks, they have discovered additive manufacturing. And they go on a Sunday afternoon, they go with their iPads to a museum, and they look around in the museum and they say, okay, but this cable card, for example, that's one that I like, that's one that I would like to put in my scenery. And they start designing on their laptop, on their tablets, they design the cable cards. And then they come home and they upload this design onto a platform, and they get the printed parts, which is, for example, this stilettography part in the middle. They get it back in their mailbox, and then they start painting it. And then they put in their scenery, and since they are really the freaks, they make pictures of it, they start blogging about it, and then suddenly all the other freaks in the world, they are seeing this. And then you have the few of those creative freaks who are also entrepreneurs. Because these people, they get in a mail from one of their colleagues in China or in the US or in Belgium or in Finland saying, hey, I like these cable cards, can I have one? And the real entrepreneurs say, here is a business opportunity. Yes, I will sell you one. And they order again online, on demand. Only when they have an order, they will order the cable cards, they will paint it, they will ship it to their customer, and they create a small business. And this is something which is creating a lot of new opportunities for small enterprises. And those small enterprises, some of them will grow to larger enterprises. I'd like to end with one example which basically happened here in Finland, and that was maybe in the times of Nokia before they were acquired by Microsoft. And this was, in fact, a very interesting experiment that Nokia did. What Nokia did was launching, when they launched their Lumia 820 in 2013, if I'm not mistaken. When they launched their Lumia 820, they were looking to create or take advantage of the hype around additive manufacturing 3D printing. And what they did was saying, okay, when you buy such a Lumia, then you can go to the website of Nokia and you can download the CAD data of the back cover, so the white cover here, on the phone, and you can print it on your home printer. When we saw this appearing in the press, we thought, well, this is really interesting. This is really shifting the way that product development is done, because this is really giving power, even manufacturing power, to the consumer. But we were also a little bit concerned, because we thought, well, if Nokia is just putting the production data online, then it may fail, because most of the people who will download it have a home printer, And those home printers are typically not so suited to make thin-walled components. So we initially bought Lumia 820. We downloaded the file. Indeed, we found out that what was available on the internet was something, a plastic device, which was injection molded and with a wall thickness of 0.8 millimeters, so very thin. And we thought, well, this will probably not work. We tried it on a couple of home printers we had at Materialize to come to the conclusion, indeed, that it wasn't working. But what we did then was basically engaging our design engineers and saying, okay, guys, here are the data. Can you do something creative with it? And just in a few hours' time, you see that those creative people, they come up with complete new designs, yeah? Like this one here or this one here, where you can slide your key card of the hotel into your phone, or one that you can mount on your bicycle. And this is showing that if companies are experimenting, and those who will do the real proper experimentation, I'm convinced that they will succeed, that they can really come into co-creation with the consumer and will be able to make or differentiate themselves against their competitors by really involving the consumer and by really giving the voice to the consumer in making products and their products, giving a new personalized look.